Good afternoon to everybody. Let me thank the organizers for having invited RSC at this opening plenary session of the IT 2020 conference. Also, it's an honor to speak after two very important actors, I would say very big giants, in the arena of the Italian power system. I will try to address a specific field of research, which is but one of the fields of research which we investigate in RSC. In particular, the point I would like to touch today has to do with mobility and power system research. And we named this presentation an exciting journey. It's a journey which is one of the different dimensions of the power system research which is running in these very years in order to evolve the total ecosystem. We are running towards a more decarbonized power system, and there are many directions in the research we are running in these years. Electric mobility is just one of these directions, but I took this as an example because to me there are some specific characteristics of this research which make it evident that a new trend, which at the beginning was seen like a threat or a menace for the power system, now can become really a positive asset for the system itself. As I told you, I choose this dimension because in the last decade, and our journey takes one decade, and we compare here some data relevant to 2009 with respect to the ones on the right of 2019. During this long journey, vehicles have changed. For instance, the number of total vehicles which have been sold in the system, in the Italian system, are still a small number, but it's very big if you compare it with the figure relevant to 10 years ago. And the same is valid for the number of models which are available on the shelf or on the market for Italian citizens who are willing to enter this new dimension of electric mobility. Now, as of 2019, we are in the presence of more than 25 models, but if you look at the data in this very month of 2020, you will find out that more than 50 models are now available. And the same evolution or strong change was observed in the dimension of batteries. Now, the current dimension of batteries has to do with 40 to 60 kilowatt hours, and projections are there for 100 kilowatt hours of capacity. Also, an observation has to be made about the capital cost needed to enter electromobility. It has not diminished that much during the course of time, but there are now some public support instruments like the Ecobonus for the Italian system, which make it possible for a citizen to have, let me say, to mitigate the difference between the initial expenditure needed for an electric vehicle with respect to the one which is needed for a traditional internal combustion engine vehicle. The journey is important also if you look at the dimension of infrastructures, of charging infrastructures. Here, figures have changed dramatically. In particular, as of now, in Italy, there are more than 10,000 public charging points, and the power at which you can charge at these poles is now up to around 100-150 kilowatt, and supercharges are at the horizon, and we look forward 300 kilo of power for charging vehicles. Also, there are in place standards which are common to the total European Union, which are well defined and make it possible for Italian drivers to drive even in other countries in our continent. Clear business models have been now enforced by the action of the Alternative Fuel Directive, and also interoperability, as I mentioned, is now at a very good level. The third dimension which I'd like to touch in electromobility, or the third dimension of our journey, has to do with the power system. As I told you in the introduction, in the past, the advent of the recharging process was seen like a possible threat for the system. Now it becomes an opportunity for the national energy system, because with the smart charging and V2G functionalities, we found a key solution even to manage the RES increase. I'm talking about intermittent RES, which can take advantage of the presence of a big number of electric vehicles and the relevant batteries. So it has become now a crucial technology to decarbonize the transport sector. So what is the role of RSC in this playground? We are realizing tools and analysis to study the mobility evolution and electrification. We use a multidisciplinary approach, a systemic one. The final goal is to provide all stakeholders, which can be manufacturers, operators, but finally researchers, policymakers, and final users and citizens, with data, results, report, and technical advice on the matter, which can be seen in four different dimensions. We investigate scenarios and impacts, and this is well known since the National Energy and Climate Plan has been prepared by the relevant ministry, but with the collaboration of many partners, among which even RSE has worked on scenarios. Also, we are on the technology side. We run comparisons between electric vehicles and internal combustion engine vehicles using the LCA method. We try to investigate which are the obstacles for final users to enter this new idea of mobility in order to remove these obstacles. And even this is related with the different mobility models which one can imagine for developing not only public private transport, but even the public transport in this field. One key aspect of our everyday work has to do with support to policymakers. We look at research as an instrument to promote technological development, and this is quite common, but also to support policymaking. And we are trying to use a robust and impartial system approach, trying to stay in the community, and this is very good to speak here at the conference of today, because always we need to have strict links and relationships with other scientists and universities, so in order to participate in the field of innovation. Now I will list some few key experiences in the point of supporting institutions in sustainable mobility. The very first experience is quite old. We are back to 2016, more or less. We were the technical advisor of a working group which was coordinated by the Italian Prime Minister's Office with our support, with more than 80 stakeholders involved. The point was to discuss in order to find a consensus about the evolution of the transport sector, involving the mobility demand and offer, the technologies which were available, the different supply chains of our country, but also the external effects, and finally the policies needed. In the end, we collected the standpoint of different stakeholders. As you see, they are very diverse, starting from the authority of regulation, but even car manufacturers, even other technology and science poles. All these different actors were sitting at the same table, and the point was to find as final result a paper, a public paper, which we called Elements for a Sustainable Mobility Roadmap. In this synthetic work, there is the state of the art at that point of time and the possible evolutions towards the future. We took advantage of this experience even at the later stage when we worked for the Ministry of Economic Development, for which we work normally every day. Here we are active in the so-called discussion table about automotive, in which again many stakeholders are gathered in order to find possible solutions which may become then legal provisions like decrees or laws or incentives or new rules. This is done again to support the action of the Ministry of Economic Development in this field. One specific point has to do with the so-called PUN, la Piattaforma Unica Nazionale, which is will be there to support citizens when they drive with their electrical vehicle, they go around the country, they need to have in their hands all the information relevant to charging poles which are available, their current status, and whatever it takes to lower or to mitigate the so-called range anxiety, which is one of the obstacles in the direction of electromobility. Also, we support the ministry when they study potential support schemes, which can be monetary or non-monetary. For a while, I would like to focus on non-monetary schemes. It's the point, for instance, of having easier permitting procedures in order to install recharging infrastructures. This is a point which is of importance for our country, for instance. Also, we were active in the studies and analysis which preceded the so-called V2G decree, which recently has been put in place by the ministry. Again, on support to institutions, we work in close contact with the ARERA, which is the Sectoral Regulatory Authority for Energy, Environment and Networks. And here the point is a current focus group which is focusing on three different aspects which have to do with private charging stations, and here the tariff impact is of importance, public charging, even again with some tariff profiles which are studied and investigated, and also we collect technical parameters of vehicles and prospective recharging poles in order to understand how the regulator can drive this sector towards the future. All this information for sure will be exploited for the public good, not only for the regulator, but even for the ministry. In particular, we are close not only to the Ministry of Economic Development, but also to the Ministry of Infrastructure and Transport. And having stated this, I would like to focus your attention on some key topics which are now investigated. The first topic is a more technical one. It is the impact on distribution grids. As you see by the graph, it is crucial to manage and to control the recharging process. If we don't do this, it will become a completely random process in which users will charge a vehicle totally regardless of the impact of the grid. And if you do this, as the graph well explains, you will incur unanticipated costs for network expansion, which can be avoided if you use a more controlled process of recharging. This is a simple case. There are more complex cases involving not only domestic recharge, like you see in the graph, but even public high-power recharge stations, which need to be controlled in a suitable manner in order to avoid overloads and, again, unanticipated expansion of the grid. Another key topic to us is the one I mentioned before. It is to look at the midterm perspective of 2030, observing that the prospective power system will be totally dominated by RES. In particular, intermittent RES, as you see by the figures, will cover more or less one third of the total national load. And this will bring also the need for new storage systems, which we have estimated at around 50 gigawatt hour of capacity. Now, if you look at the other side, which is electromobility, you may discover that in the same National Energy and Climate Plan, also it is forecasted that we will have 4 million of pure electric vehicles at 2030. And if you simply assume that each and every of these battery takes 40 kilowatt hour of energy, which is a prudent estimation, the total number you may find out is kind of amazing, because it is three times the need for storage systems at the same point of time. For sure, this is only a theoretical potential, because if I buy an electric vehicle, it is not for serving the grid, it is for driving around, but there will be some points of time, maybe during daytime, maybe during the night, if you talk about domestic charge, in which many, many of these batteries will be fully available for the system. So our investigations are in this field, and in particular in our test facility in RSE, we are testing these electric vehicles like flexible load. This is the so-called V2G pilot project, which we are running together with NLX and Nissan. We have two electric vehicles. I drive one of these two vehicles, so I am part of the experiment, let me say. We have two bidirectional poles with 50 kilowatt each in direct current. We are experimenting and testing different usage profiles, maybe daytime or night charge, but also using this for company cars. And in essence, there are two directions we have individuated. One is the so-called vehicle to grid, so we are using energy stored in batteries in order to provide different services to the system, like frequency containment reserve, frequency restoration reserve, but even balancing, and more services can be packaged together. And also we are using vehicle to home function, which means probably the owner of electric vehicles will be also the owner of some PV panels. In that case, he or she can benefit of the car as a source of storage in order to maximize or optimize the use of photovoltaic energy they are producing. Another key topic has to do again with flexibility, but in this case we investigate domestic charging. If you look at advanced countries in the field of electromobility, you will discover that roughly 80% in all advanced countries of the total energy of recharge for electric vehicles is taken like domestic recharge. So the role of the public recharge is quite limited in energy terms. It means that we will have a bunch of cars plugged in, especially during the night, at domestic users' wall boxes, like the one you see in the slide, and we may control the flow of energy towards this battery. Now it is no longer a bidirectional control. We are talking about V1G in this case, which means we are just, let me say, controlling, shaping in a more opportune manner the profile by which the user is taking energy from the grid, for instance, during the night at home. The last point, and by this I will close, sorry for taking your time, but this point is I would say important to me personally, because I feel that not only we need to make experiments, but also we need to prove on ourselves that these experiments may work. This is the case of the electrification of the fleet and of the experimental recharging area. What we are doing, by the end of 2020, we will have finished by electrification of the fleet, which means that RSC as a company will own around 20 vehicles as full vehicles or mixed use vehicles. And we will use a combination of battery electric vehicles plus plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. So we will try to use RSC as a case study. We want to prove that having a totally decarbonized fleet can be a positive experience for companies of our dimension and size, or even for other public administrations. Also, we will run dynamic charging management, because we have put in place an infrastructure obtained by different manufacturers of charging infrastructures. And by doing this, we test advanced controllers to limit or to optimize the overall connection power with respect to the grid, which is one parameter of cost, and also for testing V1G provision of services to the grid. In the end, what I expect, I would say what I hope, this is more a wishful thinking, but we are running the experiment, is that by this economical and functional comparison, we will find out that owning an electric fleet as company fleet has positive advantages, not only for the environment, but also for the company itself. So I feel that this could be more efficient than owning a traditional conventional diesel fleet. At least this is my expectation. Sorry for taking your time with this last slide. By this, I am over, and I hope that during the conference, the theme of electromobility will be treated even in more detail. Thank you.